Thank you, Jesus. As Deacon Frank said earlier, we should be finishing up this book, short book, but chock full of meat for even we who live in our time. We're back in our study in this book of Jonah. By way of review, we're starting in chapter 3, beginning at verse 6. We know pretty much what has been happening all along. We know that this prophet did not want to do what God wanted him to do, and he decided to go contrary, to go the other way. And we know that he ended up in a whale of a jail cell. And I dare say, and I mentioned this before, that many times when we go contrary, that the Lord will have to chastise us and sometimes put us in a timeout as he's trying to get us to understand what he would have us to do and not what we want to do. Amen? Amen. He says in verse 6 of chapter 3, if you're with me, please say amen. Amen. He says, for word, and by the way, we know that Jonah came into Nineveh. He was obedient to God. The whale had spit him out on the shore. And halfway into this place, he began to preach this simple message. And we know that God had already prepared this people for that message and prepared Jonah to be able to get it. And they repented, of course. And in verse 6, it says, for the word came unto the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, and he laid his robe, it says, from him, and covered him with sackcloth. And I love this part. He didn't just put ashes on him. It says, and sat in ashes. And look, it's an outward showing of what's going on in his heart. God had prepared Nineveh, even prepared this king to repent, but only at the word that God had given to his prophet, Jonah. In verse 7, it says, and he caused it to be proclaimed and published, it said, throughout Nineveh by the decree of the king and his nobles. So the king and all his cabinet, they were in agreement. It says, saying, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. Let them not feed nor drink water. And so in other words, he called a national fast for everybody. He went on, verse 8, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily unto God, yea, let them turn. Look what he says, not only just call out to God, but let them turn, it says, everyone from his evil way and from the violence that is in their hands. And look, what he knew is that there was some evil going on when God's prophet preached the word, and the word was traveling all through. The king proclaimed a fast, and I mentioned last week that it would be nice if God got a hold of one of our leaders, and they started this thing as well. But even more so than that, guys, especially in the time we live in, it would be nice if God's church, the called out ones, would turn from their wicked ways and do what God has called us to do and get on the one so that we can be one in Christ. I dare say we would see a change in our world as well. He goes on in verse 10. Look at verse 9 again. He says, who can tell if God will turn and repent and turn away from his fierce anger that we perish not? And listen, they're saying that we need to do everything that we can to get God's attention. Because I don't know if they knew before, but they realize it now, that God is their problem. And if they don't do right by God, they know that they're going to perish. And so they see him as their only solution. And even in us, with us, guys, sometimes in this time, when we're going through, and there are some that are going through right now, some who are here, some who are watching me on the video, and they go through this on this side and go through this on that side, and they're trying to figure this whole thing out. And I'll simply say it again. If God is your problem, then he will be your only solution. Amen? Guys, please be prayerful with me as I preach around this sermon series. Be sure your sin will find you out. And Father, as we dive deeper into this book, and Lord, if you say so, we'll finish it up this day. And I pray in the name of Jesus for the nuggets that we're going to see today, Father God, that you'll help us to glean some truths that will be applicable even to our lives. That, Father God, you'll meet us at our most dire place. And Lord, bless us with some understanding and some spiritual information that will be a blessing not just to our here and now, but a blessing to our later on throughout our lives. Father, we thank you, we praise you, we say yes to your will and to your way. I pray that you will hide me behind the cross of Christ and allow these words to be words that you have handpicked for this congregation. And Father God, may they be inherited by your Spirit as you teach and preach through your servant, as I pray in Jesus' name and for his name's sake. Amen. And amen. In verse 10 of chapter 3, we read, "And God saw their works, that they turned from their evil way, and God repented of the evil that he had said he would do unto them, and he did it not." And listen, I kind of left that verse for last because I see that, and I see that even in our lives, God, that many times with us and how we're living and which way we're going, that look, as God's children, we know that he loves us. And the word says that those he loves, he will chastise. And there are times with these we see with Nineveh that they gave God another option, that he did not have to destroy them because they got right in their hearts, at least right then. We know later on they got faulty, but right here, right now, they did repent, and not only just say it, they did it by their deeds. So God was given another opportunity to show grace, even in the Old Testament, and rather than strike them down and utterly do away with them, he was able to bless them and not destroy their land. In chapter 4, verse 1, it says, "But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was very angry." Now, we're going to see here in these verses that he's going to give us the reason why he didn't want to go and that this really is it. But guys, it doesn't much matter what you want, doesn't much matter what I want. Ultimately, we need to let God be God, and we ought to pray that his will be done. There's some things in my life that I wish I could have done a different way. We were talking before the service about some jobs I wish I had taken and how it would have worked out. But guess what? God worked it out in a way that he wanted it to be. And you know what I found? Since I've been in Christ, and I suspect you found it as well, that when the Lord is moving in my life, when he's sending me here or moving me there, that he never says in my heart, "Brother Ralph, wake up. Do you think it would be okay if I send you here or if I call you to do this? How do you feel about that, Brother Ralph?" And listen, God never does that. He simply does and says what he does and what he says. And listen, in particular with his word that we know is inerrant, that is correct, that I can't change this or switch this around to suit my life. He never asks my opinion. He simply says go and do, or either stop doing something that he would have me to stop. Because what I know is that Father knows best. And this is something that prophet is learning. And then we get all the way to the end, and you wonder whether or not he truly learned it. But it says in verse 1 of chapter 4, "But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was very angry." And by the way, who do you suppose he's angry at? He can't be angry at Nineveh. They simply responded to God. Listen, he's angry at God. And listen, that's not a good place to be either, especially for a prophet. In verse 2 it says, "And he prayed unto the Lord, and said, I pray thee, O Lord, was not this my saying when I was yet in my country? Therefore I fled before," he says, "unto Tarshish, for I knew that thou art a gracious God and art and merciful, slow to anger and of kindness, and repented thee of the evil." And listen, indeed, he is a gracious God, because for one thing, Jonah's still breathing here. And if he wasn't gracious, he would not be. He's a gracious God in regard that though he ran from him, he still blessed those mariners and helped them to be saved physically and helped them to be saved spiritually, and he didn't have to do that. He's a gracious God because he has just had this whole place called Nineveh have repented and gotten right with him. And though it was God's will, and though God called that to be, it upset and angered his prophet, because this guy, he was prejudiced against these guys, and he did not want them to succeed. He did not want them to be saved. He wanted this nation to be torn down, this city to be torn down, because that was his will. And in our lives, guys, as we go through and trek through lives, there's some things that we want to do and some things we also want to do. But I got to tell you, if God is saying no, you can kick against that. You can box against that. You can do whatever you want to do like this prophet. But whatever God says, God means. And we need to get on board like this prophet needed to get on board. And listen, he's done it in actuality, but it appears that his heart is still not quite there. Amen? In the middle of verse 2, he says, I knew that thou art a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness, and repented thee of the evil. Therefore, he says, now, O Lord, take, I beseech thee, my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And guys, every time I read this, I want to rename him the dying prophet, because it seems like rather than doing what God tells him to do, he wants to die. Rather than go and preach to Nineveh, he goes on a ship. Rather than get right and tell them to take him back so he can do what God called them to do, he tells them to throw him overboard. And look, he just came out of the belly of a whale, and he's still fussing and still does not quite see what God is trying to tell him to do. And he says, I might as well die. And there are times in folks' lives, even now, that I talk to them and I see how they're living. And I recognize that they're not really living as they ought to be living, and they're calling themselves Christians. And I can see, and look, it really is easier to see sin in someone else. Sometimes hard to see it in yourself. But when you see somebody that's consistently living outside of the righteousness of God, and you tell them and you speak to them, and many times they will say to you, and I've heard that. In fact, I've heard it this week. That they will say, well, I'd be so glad when the Lord comes and raptures the church out, because I'm just sick of being here, and he'll just take us out and we'll have a happy hallelujah in heaven forever and ever and ever. And that's true. But the way that some folks say that to me, it helps me to know that you had no intentions of cleaning up your act. You had no intentions of stopping what you're doing. You have no intention to stop living the way you're living. And listen, you almost want to die because you're not going to stop. So God might as well take you home. And this is what this prophet is saying. Look, you didn't do what I wanted you to do, so I might as well die. Guys, understand that we are the pawns. He's the potter, and he tells us what to do. We don't do what we want to do. And when his ways contradict our ways, guess which ways we are to pick up and which way we are to go? Because God's will be done, and he will always have the last word. And if he's called you to do something, be it now, they used to have a candy out called now and laters. You're either going to do it now or you're going to do it later. But as long as you're breathing, you are going to do it. And he says at the end of this verse that it's better for me to die than to live. He goes on in verse 4. Then said the Lord, doest thou well. It says to be angry. And listen, what he's saying is, in some versions will say it this way, that do you have a right to be angry? If anybody should be angry, it should be the Lord angry at him. And guys, there are times in our lives, because it's not going the way we want it to go, that we get angry as well. Maybe we get angry at our spouses. Maybe we get angry at our family. But many times we get angry at the Lord without actually saying it. and he's angry with the Lord and not actually saying it, and because it didn't go the way we wanted. The Lord said, I want you to this is the woman I want you to marry. This is the man I want you to marry. And somebody will say, well, I want to marry them. Or I want to marry her. And the Lord said, well, no, that's not your wife. This is the one I want you to marry. And you go outside of his spiritual understanding of information, and you marry who you want to marry, and then that thing falls off the cliff and don't work out well, and then you're mad. But who you mad at? I'm mad at me, or ought to be mad at me. I'm the one that made that call. And you're the one that made that call. When God said, shut this thing down and don't let it go any further. And sometimes we push past what God wants because we want it so bad. And it's almost like a kid. And I see some in the store sometimes. But I want it. And they'll pick up a toy and throw it in the cart. The parent will keep putting it back. But I want it. And they give it a temper tantrum. And in reality, that's what this prophet is doing. He's kicking up a fuss and giving a temper tantrum. In verse 4, it said, then said the Lord, do thou well to be angry, or should you even be angry? And again, he's angry at the Lord. Verse 5, it says, so Jonah went out of the city and sat on the east side of the city, and there made him a booth. So he made himself a little shelter. He went outside the city, he made a little shelter. It says, and sat under it in the shadow till he might see what would become of the city. So he got himself a nice little vantage point here in verse 5. And he's going to set up a little booth. And he's going to get comfortable because he wants to see how this whole thing is going to play out. In verse 6 it says, and the Lord God, look, provided a gourd. And listen, some kind of large plant. And it had large leaves. It says, and made it to come up over Jonah, that it might be a shadow over his head, to deliver him, it says, from his grief. So Jonah was exceeding glad of the gourd. So the Lord knew he was steaming, knew he was fuming. So he had this plan. He made it grow up real quick, and a leaf came over his head. He was already in a timeout. The Lord made it help to cool down just a little bit because he knew he needed this timeout. And he even helped him. And I think this is the first time when we see that Jonah, with the exception of him being asleep on that ship, this is the first time we've actually seen something happen and he's actually glad about it, because he has been stewing from the moment God called him to go to Nineveh. And it says he was exceeding glad of the gourd. And look at verse 7. Look, God's not playing with him, but he is trying to teach him a valuable life lesson. He says in verse 7, but God prepared a worm when the morning rose the next day, and it smote the gourd that it withered. So he's sitting there, he was going well, and he's got shade, and then God prepared a worm. And listen, everything is being obedient, the plant, the worm, the whale, everything with the exception of Jonah. And this worm went through it like I guess he would an apple. This thing, it literally withered it down unto nothing. And in verse 8, God wasn't finished with it yet. It says, and it came to pass, when the sun did arise, that God prepared a vehement east wind, and the sun beat upon the head of Jonah, that he fainted, and look, here we go again, and wished in himself to die, and said, it is better for me to die than to live. And guys, this is one miserable prophet. And every time he turn around, he's talking about he want to die. Look, again, a gracious God, because he keeps saying this. And Lord, listen, with a word from the Lord, that could happen. But he's still trying to teach him something, still trying to show him something. And this lesson he wants his prophet to learn. In verse 9, he says, and God said to Jonah, doest thou well to be angry for the gourd? In other words, you have a right to be angry for this gourd, for the plant that I put over. He says, and he said, I do well to be angry, and even unto death. And he keeps calling this death thing up. He keeps trying to get say it's better for him to die. It's like, oh, poor me. Everything is happening to me. And guys, I hear that even in our time, and I look at some folks' lives, and it seems like every day something new is coming up, and every night something else is coming up behind that, and this is okay, and they have peace for a minute, and then it starts all over again. And look, I know in my life, and sometimes it does get that way. And I stop and I say, Lord, what am I missing here? Are you trying to tell me something here? Did I blow it over here, or did I blow it over there? Or is there something you want me to see that I'm not seeing? Please let me know, because these things are coming into my life rapid fire, and I fear that maybe I miss a point that you were trying to make. Lord, please help me to understand what's going on. And guys, all things that happen to you are not necessarily because of something you've done. And once I realize that my slate is clean, that I'm right with the Lord, I know that he still allows and sometimes sends things into your life for his purposes. And ultimately, we'll understand it better by and by. If I get in a car accident, I'm asking, Lord, why did that happen? If I'm getting sickly, Lord, is there something I need to see in the midst of this? And God always has a plan for each one of us. And in fact, he said that even the hairs on your head are numbered, and each one that falls out, he knows what that number is. So he's intimately involved in my life and in your life, and nothing happens. He said nothing falls to the ground, that a sparrow falls not even to the ground without him knowing about it. He's intimately involved in all parts of our lives, and especially for a believer, for one that knows the Lord. He knows you, and he knows what you need, and he knows when you need it. And again, Father always knows best. Amen. We see this prophet, and we see that he's being super selfish. And look, he sees things that it's all about him. And I suppose there are times in our lives when we get selfish ourselves, and we get self-centered, and somebody hurting over there. And look, you might talk about it for a minute, but you drop it because you want to get back to talking about me, because it's all about me. And God said, no, it's all about me. It's all about God. And in the midst of whatever you're going through, he said, give me the glory. And again, if indeed he did send this thing, or we know he allowed it, we need to go to him in order to get some relief and make sure that we're right in our hearts with him. He says in verse 9, and God said to Jonah, doest thou well to be angry for the gourd? And he said, I do well to be angry, even unto death. Then said the Lord, verse 10, thou hast had pity on the gourd, on that plant. It says, for the which thou had not labor, nor madest it grow. In other words, you didn't have nothing to do with that. That was a blessing from me. It was mine, and I gave it to you. He says, which came up at night and perished in the night. And listen, he's saying, you got a compassion for this plant that really has no soul, and it means nothing. It came because I gave it to you, and now it's gone because I took it away. And by the way, the Lord does give, and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord, because he's righteous in whatever he does. Amen. And he's trying to get this prophet to see something, and I'm not sure if he actually got what God was trying to show him. In verse 11, it says, and should I not spare Nineveh, that great city, wherein are more than 60,000 people that cannot discern, he says, between their right hand and their left hand, and also much cattle. And what the Lord is saying to him is, he's talking about little kids that are 3 or 4 years old. They don't know their right from the left. And he's saying that there are 100,000 at least kids. And if there's that many kids that don't know one thing from the other, that there must be more adults. And listen, up to 500,000-600,000 kid people. And he's saying that you worried about this plant, and there are 600,000 folks
that have just been saved and you care not nothing for them because you want your will to be done and not mine. And God said, that ain't never be happening. Because again, it's not about you, Jonah, but it's all about me and what I want to happen. We don't know a whole lot about Jonah, what happened after this. We know that Nineveh actually got sinful and God did have to deal with them down the road. But we see this prophet, and we were talking earlier before the service, and we were talking about old movies, how they the acting is so good. And my wife turned me on to Turner Classic Movies, and I like them because they be acting and they be giving it everything they got. And it's not like a whole lot of action sometimes, but the acting is so good and the storylines are so good, it turns out always to be a good movie. And I love them. But there's something about those movies I don't like. They always just end. Somebody's walking down the road and you're looking at the time and the clock and this thing get ready to go off. There's no way they're going to conclude this. I need to know what's happening to him or what happened to her. And the movie will just end. And they leave a whole lot to your imagination because you don't know if they died, if they lived, or they got back together. You don't know anything. And that's what I see with this book of Jonah. It just ends. But guess what? To God be the glory anyhow, because he taught or tried to teach his prophet something. He tried to help him to understand that it's not about him and that it's all about Jesus Christ for us. And we need to know that, look, in your life, as God is ministering, as God is blessing, as God is showing, that we need to learn some lessons from this prophet here. That when God speaks, that we're to act and react, and we're to do it for as long as God says do it. And listen, when God tells me something that I'm to do or stop doing, I don't have to ask him, well, what about my wife? Is she going to stop doing it? No. He said, no, I'm talking to you. And you be obedient to me. And guys, what I find is that when I'm obedient and I do what God is telling me to do, you know what happens? Things get right. And I don't understand fully how God does it. But many times he's speaking to my heart for the purposes of what else he's trying to do. And I don't have to worry about what you're doing. You don't have to worry about what I'm doing. But we all ought to worry or concern ourselves with what God is telling us to do in regard to ministry, in regard to life, in regard to living life. He has given all of us X amount of years on this side. And I've gotten to the place in my life now that really, in reality, I just want to do what he wants me to do when he wants me to do it. And I do the best I can. I believe I'm getting better at that. And what I find is that when I am obedient, that it just is a blessing, not just for me. It's a blessing for the congregation. It's a blessing for folk I hang around with. It's a blessing for my wife and for my household because I'm doing what he said. And listen, if somebody who I'm ministering to, if they never get right, that's between them and the Lord. I'm going to do what he's called me to do. Because unlike this prophet, I need peace in my life and peace, hallelujah, in my heart. And that comes for us from the Prince of Peace, who is Jesus Christ. And as I'm doing what the Father has ordained for me to do, then he gives me his peace that passes all understanding. Unlike this prophet who's walking around angry and mad and upset and wanting to die every other day of his life because things never went the way he thought they should go. Please know that Father knows best. He really does. And he's looking out for the best of all of us. And when we go his way, it might not seem like it's going to fit. It might not seem like it's going to work. It might seem like, well, how's that going to do anything? And he simply says, oh, taste and see that the Lord, he is good.
And he knows more than what you know, and he knows more than what I know. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, dear Lord, for blessing us through this book of Jonah, and Father, allowing us to glean some truths that will be applicable even to us in the new covenant, Father God. We pray in the name of Jesus for each and everyone who's within the sound of my voice and for each one that's watching me on this video, Lord, that you'll continue to minister to them and bless them in a mighty and a special way. And Father God, where we've fallen short, please help us to know so that we can get right, so that we can repent, so that we can get back on that street called straight and be able to be used by you once again. Father, we thank you. We praise you. We say yes to your will and to your way. And Father, as we go into our communion service, I pray even for the elements that we're using, the unleavened wafers and Father God, the grape juice, that you'll bless them to be used from a secular use into a spiritual use, as we remember your broken body and your shed blood, that you had your son do for us. We thank you and we praise you as we pray in Jesus' name and for his name's sake. Amen. And amen. As it says in your bulletin, we're going to 1 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And we're going to look at a few verses here that are dealing with our communion. Thank you, Lord. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. That would be page 996 if you're using a pew Bible. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and zero in on verse 23. And I will start my reading there. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning at verse 23. Page 996. If you're there, please say amen.
Amen.
And Paul writes here, he says, and by the way, he's writing to this Corinthian church, and they were out of order in a whole lot of ways. And we know especially or in particular when it came to the Lord's Supper. It says, for I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. And look, we know he was talking to his disciples, and they were at the Last Supper, and he was ministering to them and letting them know he was getting ready to go away. But while I am away, I need you to remember me, and every time that you partake of this supper, it will be a remembrance of what I have done for you. And look, he's telling them this, and he hadn't even gone to the cross yet, but from the spiritual, it was already a done deal. In verse 25, it says, after the same manner, he took the cup, and when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. And again, likewise with the drink, with the cup, that they were to remember him and remember his shed blood. In verse 26, it says, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. And by the way, he is coming back. Know that. Verse 27 says, wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But, excuse me, let a man examine himself. And so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. And listen, he's saying that there are rules to us partaking of these elements. That if we're not right in our hearts, that we're not to fool around with this thing, we're to pass it by. If we don't know Christ as our Lord and Savior, then we're not to fool around with this. We're to let it pass us by until we get right. He says in verse 30, for this cause, many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep.
And look, he's saying sleep, and he's talking to believers, so he's talking about dying. There are some who have messed around with this table so often that God says, I see that you're going to keep living in sin, you're going to keep being a sinner and calling yourself a saint, that look, I'm not going to let you tear my name down as you're walking around saying I'm a Christian and living like a sinner or living like you live in hell. He says, I'm just going to call you on home because this is where you need to be because you're not going to get right in regard to the way you're living. He says in verse 30, for this cause, many, he says, are weak and sickly among you and many sleep. For if, verse 31, we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the Lord, with the world. And listen, he's talking about when he judges us, we've already been judged and found guilty. But the kicker is that Christ has already paid for our sins. And though all our sins are paid for, there are consequences for the things that we do here in this life. And he said that because we belong to him, that he chastens us like a parent would a child. And he does what's necessary, like he did with that prophet, to get us back where we need to be in right stead with him so that we can serve him in spirit and in truth. Verse 33 says, wherefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, tarry one for another. And if any man hunger, let him eat at home, that he come not together unto condemnation. And the rest, he says, will I set in order when I come. Again, real quick, the Lord's table set aside for the Lord's people. If you're right in your heart, then this table is for you. If you're not right in your heart, then this table is not for you, and you need to let it pass by. And just to make sure we're okay with the Lord, we're going to take a moment. Each of us will pray and make sure that we're all right with our Lord and Savior. Any sin in your life, you can repent of it right now. Not to pick it up when you leave here and go back to it, but repent right now, get right with the Lord, and then you can partake of this table. Amen? Amen?
Amen.
Let us take a moment and let us pray.